Smart companies know that they need good data engineers. And there's a good reason for that. Data management is going to separate those companies that excel in the next decade versus those that start to fall behind a little bit. And that's why it really shouldn't be a surprise that data engineering in particular has become one of the most in-demand jobs. So in this video, I want to discuss how we even got to this point and then start to think about where things are headed for us in the future. Now, just as a heads up, this one is going to be more of me just talking as opposed to the usual tutorial style that I do, but I'm going to try to cover like 20 years of progress in about 5 minutes. So let's get started. If we were to travel back in time to the early 2000s, a time of innocence with AIM and MySpace, in the corporate world, we'd see a very clear divide between the IT department and then pretty much everyone else. Most database related things were on premises and probably managed exclusively by a few database administrators, or DBAs for short. Spreadsheets were used a lot because it really wasn't straightforward to get custom data from the databases themselves. The rise of the internet at this time brought about a lot of new business applications, but that also meant new data and data that was scattered and wildly inconsistent. The solution then at that point was to focus mostly on centralization and data modeling into what we all refer to as data warehouses. By the end of the decade, companies started to focus a lot more on digitizing everything. IT and business functions started to blend together more than in the past, and people started slowly realizing just how much value this data stuff could really have in making decisions. So those companies that kind of leaned in heavily into using data around this time were able to gain a really big competitive advantage. This increased interest was great, but a traditional IT department couldn't really keep up with this new demand for custom data all by themselves. So by this time, a lot of companies began to focus on more structured ETL processes and data pipelines that could help automate some of the work. The mid-2010s saw a pretty major shift towards even more data-driven apps and technology in general. I mean, just think about the explosion of social media apps around this time. We saw the rise of modern cloud databases like Snowflake and Amazon Redshift. Full-on data teams were becoming a thing at companies where it may not have been really considered before. There was also a ton of really important innovation happening at the biggest tech companies. So we're talking Amazon, Facebook, Google, who, unsurprisingly, were some of the first ones to see the real impact that big data could have and was probably already having at that time. So this is where we started to see software engineers being called upon to help build some of these more complex components to make it all work. But at the same time, all this innovation also had other side effects. One in particular being the huge increase in the amount of new tools flooding the marketplace. We also started to see more data silos beginning to pop up within companies, and security becoming obviously a bigger concern. But of course, there's always some sort of response, and this time the focus began to shift towards what we now refer to as modern data engineering. By the mid-2010s, it was pretty much standard practice across the board to have an internal analytics team that managed a data warehouse, the data pipelines, and provided custom reporting. Many companies still followed ETL processes, but this ELT format started to become a lot more popular because of the wider adoption of cloud databases. With all these new tools and integrations that were required, the data engineers were relied on really heavily to create and manage the back end of this constantly growing tech stack. You also started to see more people outside of just the core data team begin to develop more advanced data literacy. And then because of that, business users now wanted more control. And so you started to hear this term self-service analytics become a really big buzzword and something that people really wanted. All right, this brings us to today, the early 2020s. We've officially gone from MySpace to TikTok and from spreadsheets to data streaming. Today, more companies continue to migrate to the cloud, which makes that ELT approach much more common. Architectures consist of multiple tools, many of which are open source now, and the influence of software engineering principles can be felt pretty much across the stack. Data operations has officially evolved from more of an ad hoc type of workflow 20 years ago to a more continuous development kind of thing with a lot of automation in a very similar fashion as traditional software development. We even have an entirely new focus area known as, uncreatively, data ops. So overall, now that hardware and storage is less of an impediment as it was maybe in the past, the focus has now shifted to development best practices and automation. Okay, so I've covered a lot of changes here, especially the stuff that happened in the last 5 to 10 years, but the technology itself isn't the only thing that's evolved. The job titles have changed as well. And obviously every company is different, so there's no really one size fits all definition. But based on my experience, here's the current lay of the land of the main roles close to data engineers. So first and foremost, we have the data engineer itself. These people are going to be mainly focused on the end-to-end integration for extracting and modeling data using a variety of tools. They'd also be expected to have an understanding of general programming, cloud platforms, infrastructure management, scheduling, amongst other things. They might also be involved in report development, but sometimes it may stop a little bit before that. Next is the data analyst. Now, the analyst will typically sit between the engineers and then business end users. They'd be expected to create dashboards and have a good understanding of the content of the data itself, but they're not going to be as technically focused as, let's say, an engineer. Next is the analytics engineer. And this is more of a recent role that's popped up, and it kind of acts as a hybrid of an engineer and then an analyst. They may not be as involved in the integrations or backend work like an engineer might be, but they would be able to use SQL-based transformation tools, you know, things like dbt, to create custom data models. They'd also be expected to understand software development best practices like version control, CI/CD, and because they're also leaning towards more an analyst, they would be able to maintain the documentation, train business users, etc. Kind of like a hybrid. And last but not least is the data scientist. And they're not going to be as involved in the backend integrations and the pipelines, modeling, all that stuff. They're more involved in creating predictive models based on the data already provided by the engineers. They'll be more statistics and math driven rather than, let's say, pipelines, integration, storage, etc. When I hear things like machine learning, I typically think data science. So where do we go from here? Obviously, I can't see into the future, but my guess is we'll continue to see evolutions within the operations part of the work. I think writing custom scripts will always be part of the job. And personally, it's my favorite part, but I also think we'll continue to see more things being abstracted away as new tools are able to handle a lot more under the hood for us. And we don't even have to worry about it. As data engineers, our value will be more on understanding how to properly configure and manage all of these different systems that are interacting with each other. But regardless of what happens, I still believe that understanding the fundamentals of any technology, whether it's data or web development or anything else, is what's going to make you better at using any new technology that comes out and using it to its full potential. For that reason, I would always still encourage people to master SQL database design and basic programming concepts. So these are just my thoughts, but what do you think? Where do you think things are headed for us over the next decade? Thanks as always for watching, and I'll see you at the next video.